Yeah, thank you. Sorry.
Many thanks. And that concludes portfolio questions for this afternoon. My apologies to those questioners I have not been able to take. We now move to the next item of business, which is the continuation of the debate on the Scottish Government's programme for Government 2015-16. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Cabinet Secretary Alec Neil as the first speaker in this afternoon's debate. Cabinet Secretary, you have 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, in delivering the programme for Government, the First Minister set out measures we will introduce over the coming year to ensure a more prosperous Scotland while creating a fairer country, improving public services and empowering our communities. There is or should be little argument that these four key elements work together to build a better country. It's an opinion shared across Civic Scotland, but today I want to give some specific examples of how they do so from my own portfolio. Creating a socially just Scotland is at the heart of what this government is trying to achieve. The First Minister's words yesterday resonated with my own experience. This summer I've travelled up and down the country asking people what a fairer Scotland should look like. All over, people have spoken of the unfairness of sanctions, of working full-time hours unable to look after their families without being topped up by the government due to low pay, of being unable to afford housing. And that cannot be right. And there are many other injustices as well that would be too numerous to mention here. As the First Minister pointed out, our new welfare powers proposed for the UK Government's current Scotland Bill fall far short of those we need to make up the harm caused by the UK Government's policies, and we will spend, as a Scottish Government, more than £100 million in the next year, as we've done this year, in mitigating the worst aspects of welfare cuts and so-called reform. Money, Presiding Officer, that could otherwise be free to be spent on making Scotland fairer rather than mitigating the mistakes of others. But in the meantime, we will do what we can with the powers we have, as well as the new powers that we will get. We will work to prepare for a social security bill better suited to Scotland's needs, which will be introduced in the first year of the new Parliament. This will include improvements to how the system works for disabled people, people with long-term health conditions and carers, giving new flexibilities within universal credit, and we're also committed, as the First Minister said, to abolishing the hated bedroom tax in the first year of the new Parliament. We will go as far as we possibly can in combining our existing powers and new powers to help those who are the most vulnerable members of our society. Of course.
Madam Fraser.
Grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Does he envisage, with these new powers, the amount of money spent on welfare in Scotland going up, going down, or remaining roughly the same?
Cabinet Secretary.
If the member had been in for question time, he would have heard me answer the same question from Alec Johnson. And the answer to that is very simple. The amount of money available will be agreed as part of the fiscal framework, which is to be agreed between the UK Government and the Scottish Government. And unfortunately, so far, we haven't seen the colour of the UK Treasury's money. And what we will not do is we will not end up in the same situation as Northern Ireland, where the Tories have placed responsibilities on that government and fell short of the funding to the tune of £70 million, as a result of which in Northern Ireland other services are suffering because the welfare in Northern Ireland has not been properly funded. Can I say, Presiding Officer, we are out to consultation, formal consultation, on what will be in our Social Security Bill and how we can make the Social Security system, and Social Security is a far better name than welfare because it sums up our philosophical approach as well, and what will be contained in that will be the result of widespread consultation, not just with those organisations who deliver social security and the third sector, but more importantly, with those people who are at the receiving end of the social security system as well. Let me go on to some other aspects of my portfolio in the 2 minutes that I have left. The introduction of our private tenancies bill will mean that private tenants are more secure in their homes, have more predictable rents, and can exert their rights without fear of eviction and limiting local rent increases. The Private Tenancies Bill will build on previous legislation passed by this chamber on the recommendation of this government to fully protect the rights and aspirations of people living in the private rented sector, which now makes up about 15% of all housing tenure in Scotland. Presiding Officer, creating a fairer Scotland goes hand in hand with creating a more prosperous one. In my portfolio, housing is at the heart of our drive to secure economic growth, promote social justice, strengthen communities, and tackle inequality. Our investment in affordable housing will exceed £1.7 billion by the end of this Parliament. Housing has been a recurring theme in the Fairer Scotland conversations I've been holding throughout Scotland during the summer. It is very clear that the provision of and access to good housing can empower communities. An established, well-maintained and warm home can also tackle inequalities and poverty. It benefits health, it benefits well-being, it benefits for security for families and individuals, and it benefits education and improves educational attainment. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, that is why in relation to housing, not only will we deliver the 30,000 new affordable homes we promised at the start of this Parliament, but by the time of the election next May, we will have exceeded that promise. And finally, Presiding Officer, can I just point out that the Help to Buy scheme itself will create 6,500 families in Scotland, and we are orientating the new scheme much more towards helping those on lower incomes. I could say much more, Presiding Officer, but I don't have the time. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. I know we're extraordinarily tight for time today, so speeches up to 6 minutes, please. Colin Malcolm Chisholm to be followed by Kenny Gibson.
Presiding Officer, I welcome much of the legislation that was announced yesterday on some of the reactive measures in relation to GPs, attainment, police and the private rented sector. But the main point here is not just that they were reactive, but reactive late on issues that Labour MPSPs have been highlighting for a long time. I spoke about GPs yesterday, so I'll spare members that. But rent controls is another good example, because no one can dispute that Labour has been pressing for that for many months. But having said that, I of course welcome the commitment yesterday that we will have, quotes, the ability to introduce local rent controls for rent pressure areas, which I assume includes my own area. I just hope that that does have genuine substance, because I heard what the Cabinet Secretary said just now about the bill more generally, but certainly I was speaking to a housing expert a few weeks ago who said that the actual central plank of that legislation in terms of private tenancy rights will actually not deliver very much in the way of substantial change. I hope he's wrong about that, but clearly there is much to discuss in relation to that. Well, notwithstanding that, there is little in the legislative programme that is likely to prove controversial. The Fiscal Commission Bill apart, where the SNP-dominated Finance Committee is leading the critical charge, as the Cabinet Secretary found at the committee this morning. Quite significant criticisms were made in their Finance Committee's report on the fiscal framework. But the central point for me is that the independence of the government advisers is absolutely central to this. But it seems to me, on the evidence that we've heard from these Central Commission members, that they're acting more like high-level advisers to the government during the forecasting process rather than scrutineers afterwards. So I think there are issues there, and I know they're shared, those concerns are shared by all members of the Finance Committee, irrespective of party. Having said that, on the fiscal framework more generally, I actually do agree with the First Minister, who said that the Scottish Parliament, would have made this point, should only approve the Scotland Bill if we have a fair fiscal framework.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr Chisholm for giving me. On the Scottish Fiscal Commission legislative proposals, could Mr Chisholm confirm to Parliament, does he believe there are any circumstances in which it is acceptable for the Fiscal Commission members to have discussions with officials of the Scottish Government?
Malcolm Chisholm.
Of course, that's perfectly acceptable. The point being that they seem to be having discussions as part of the forecasting process and therefore becoming high-level advisers. Of course, they need to discuss at various points, particularly when they're critiquing their forecasts at the end of the process. Now, moving on, I welcome the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Bill and the particular proposal proposals on revenge porn and a statutory domestic abuse aggravation. But there is disappointment among NGOs, I know, and I share it, that there is not to be a specific domestic abuse offence during this Parliament. There was a good consultation paper proposing a new criminal offence which would capture patterns of coercive and controlling behaviour between partners or ex-partners, and it is a matter of disappointment that that appears to be something that will not feature in the forthcoming legislation. I also hope that the loophole in relation to non-harassment orders only being available on conviction, I hope that that loophole will be closed, and we remember the high-profile case that was highlighted in the Herald newspaper a few months ago. I also, of course, welcome the focus on the attainment gap. At last, some members on this side might say, but again, we have to question, on the one hand, that we have £25 million a year for that, and yet a proposal from the Scottish Government that they want to save £125 million from having air passenger duty. I'm not quite sure what the official Labour front bench position is on that, but I certainly totally oppose that proposal on climate change grounds, as well as in terms of the loss in revenue for the Scottish Government. Assessment and testing in schools obviously has been a controversial area, but I have no problem about that in principle, and if done properly, it is a very good thing. I'm sure the Scottish Government is reassured by what the EIS said yesterday, that's my own union I should declare, where it talked about a Scottish design book of standardised tests to support teachers' professional judgment. Well, I hope that is what is proposed. But the key questions remain: how will the information be used, and who will have access to it? So although I welcome the principle of assessment in primary schools, I, like others, do have concerns that we may have unintended results. So we have to clearly watch that very carefully. Finally, once again, I welcome the proposals on the early years, but would make two points. Firstly, the childcare agenda, which has moved on considerably during this Parliament, still needs to be broadened out more so that it is not just focused on nursery education and that 3 to 4 year old cohort, but also crucially highlights the importance of after school care, a big gap which I'm sure all our constituents, many of our constituents, are often emphasising too. And secondly, I think there needs to be more emphasis on quality in early year services, something which was not highlighted at all in the statement yesterday. In terms of the central concern with the attainment gap, speech and language development in the early years is crucial, and that's highlighted in the Read On, Get On campaign report entitled Ready to Read, Closing the Gap on Children's Early Language Skills in Scotland. So my final point is to support three demands from the Read On, Get On campaign for, firstly, investing further in the early learning and childcare workforce, secondly, strengthening support for parents, and thirdly, introducing a child development measure for preschool children with early language skills as a key priority area within it.
That's it. Many thanks. Could I just encourage, obviously, essential conversations that require to be taken place to take place in the back of the chamber or elsewhere. Call on Kenny Gibson to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the programme for government set out by the First Minister yesterday. Of course, opposition members would expect me to support the First Minister, but don't take my word for it. Measures in the programme for government have been welcomed by organisations including the Educational Institute for Scotland, Citizen Advice Scotland, the Federation of Small Businesses, the Scottish Police Federation, Assist and Domestic Abuse Services, Community Safety Glasgow, Rape Crisis Scotland, GordonsFightback.com, the Alliance, Links Worker Programme, Shelter, the Law Society of Scotland and MND Scotland, amongst others. Since May, we have the dubious benefit of knowing that in the years ahead, Scotland will continue to be battered by cuts at the hands of a Tory majority government in Westminster, with a four-year spending review scheduled for the end of November. Therefore, a robust programme, as announced, is an absolute necessity. And over the past 5 years, the Scottish Parliament's revenue budget has been cut by 10% and capital by more than a quarter. Finance Secretary and Deputy First Minister John Swinney must take huge credit for minimising the pain of these cuts and for making the most of available resources to grow the Scottish economy. Indeed, at this morning's Finance Committee, he reminded us that construction employment in Scotland has grown by 21% over the last 12 months as a direct result of Scottish Government decisions to focus where possible on capital investment. And of course, unemployment fell in Scotland by 13,000 in the last quarter, while it rose by 25,000 across the UK. We only need to look at the Chief Economist's State of the Economy report published on 21st of August to see that despite a challenging backdrop, The Scottish economy earlier this year was in its 11th consecutive quarter of growth. It also states that growth has been recorded across all main sectors of the economy, giving the lie to the assertion that uncertainty over Scotland's constitutional future was deterring investment either here or from overseas. Between 2007, when the SNP first came to government, and 2013, the value of Scotland's international exports increased from £20 billion to £27.9 billion, an increase of 40%. And the Scottish Government has made great efforts to sustain our vital small business sector, which I know is delighted that the Small Business Bonus Scheme will be extended by another 5 years, delivering stability to our small businesses and helping them not just to survive, but thrive. Our GDP has not only returned to its pre-recession level, but surpassed it. Female employment is at a record high of 72.5%, whereas the UK rate is 68.6%. Furthermore, it seems that the Scottish Government's clear commitment to youth employment is paying off, with 363,000 young people in employment, the highest number since 2005. Between April and June of this year, 20,000 people in Scotland aged 16 to 24 were able to move into employment who did not have jobs before. This rise in youth employment is in stark contrast to the situation across the UK, where over that same period, youth employment did not increase at all. And in response to Malcolm Chisholm's comments about air passenger duty, I visited Glasgow Airport last week. They've increased their workforce over the last 3 years from 4,300 to over 5,000 and are growing the number of routes by 17 this year. Those 5,000 people include everything from baggage handlers and retail to high engineering and high-tech employment. And so airports are an engine, and they say that air passenger duty will allow them to expand much further and employ hundreds, if not thousands, of more people in the years ahead, bringing into Scotland some of the revenue Mr Chisholm fears will be lost. With regard to our NHS, the Scottish Government allocated a record £12 billion this year, and staffing levels are at a record high, with an increase in the equivalent of more than 10,500 full-time NHS workers since the SNP came to office. The Scottish Government has replaced the Tory Labour private finance initiative with a non-profit distributing model and funded investment by traditional means. In my own constituency of Cunningham North, ongoing capital projects include the new £18 million Brodick Harbour, the £43 million Garnet Academy and £12 million development at the Sports Scotland National Training Centre Inverclyde Largs, signed off 2 days ago and to be completed by December of next year. And 70 affordable houses for families, 3 and 4 apartment, will be started in Ardrossan in January. And one of the two ships announced as part of the £97 million tender won by Ferguson's will ply the Ardrossan to Brodick route, what will soon begin on a new £63 million Largs Academy campus. And Transport Minister Derek Mackay confirmed but yesterday that, in reference to the £28 million Dalry bypass delayed because of a public work inquiry, I quote, "The Scottish Government remains committed to delivering this much-needed infrastructure project." Scotland now has 1,038 more police officers than when the SNP came to office, while England and Wales numbers have fallen by more than 17,000 over 5 years. Indeed, there are fears among police chiefs south of the border that over the coming years an additional 22,000 officers will be lost. The Scottish Government ensures sustainable benefits to the Scottish economy through investing in skills and education and job creation. And in this respect, I welcome the Scottish Government's proposal to increase the number of apprentices to 30,000 by 2020. Of course, welfare reform has meant the Scottish Government has committed resources to mitigate some of the ill-thought-out policies imposed by the UK Government, such as the bedroom tax. What this illustrates is the need for further devolution, not only to abolish such impositions, but ensure they are never again imposed on Scotland. The First Minister set out how the Scottish Government plans to make use of new powers coming our way. But for fiscal devolution to work, it is essential the Scottish Government has flexibility to pursue distinct fiscal policies within an overall UK framework, fiscal framework. With regard to additional borrowing powers proposed by the Smith Commission, those for current spending need to be significantly increased and should be commensurate with the risks faced by the Scottish Government post-Smith, whilst prudential borrowing over current capital departmental expenditure limits is necessary to increase investment. Presiding Officer, what of the Labour opposition in all this? It has decided to furl itself to London while the UK party staggers from crisis to crisis, incoherent, inept, inward-looking, riddled with infighting. They have lost the trust of the people. By contrast, ambition, vision, ideas
are the hallmark
of this Scottish Government. With more powers in a year ahead, we will do even more to realise Scotland's potential, which, as members on these benches realise, will only be met with full independence.
Thanks very much. Now call on Murdo Fraser, to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is always a pleasure to follow the fair-minded and balanced convener of the Finance Committee. I am sure he would agree with me that this was a very good week for the Scottish economy. The Chancellor, George Osborne, was in town with two significant announcements. The first was of a massive investment of some £500 million in Faslane of UK taxpayers' money, safeguarding nearly 7,000 jobs on the Clyde. And the second, a £3 billion investment by the Danish firm Maersk to develop the Culzean gas field in the North Sea, securing 6,000 jobs and creating 400 more. All excellent news for the Scottish economy and for Scottish workers. Now, we might have expected both these announcements to get a warm welcome from the Scottish Government for the jobs safeguarded and for the new ones created and for the inward investment this represents. Instead, what we had was a negative carping response from the First Minister to the investment in Faslane. We can only imagine what the response had been, Presiding Officer, had the Chancellor proposed a cut in investment in the Clyde. So I turned to the programme for government, looking for a more constructive approach to the economy. And there are some things in what was announced yesterday that we would welcome. The First Minister stated she wanted to make Scotland the best part of the UK in which to do business, with an ambition for us to be the real northern powerhouse. That is something the Scottish Conservatives support. So we welcome, for example, the planned root and branch review of the planning system to see how it can better support the economy. We welcome the extension of the small business bonus scheme, but I would ask why, if it is here to stay, it should not now be set in statute. We welcome the pledge on creating a competitive business rates regime, although that will come as some surprise to those running a sporting business in rural Scotland or farmers with sporting rights over their lands, whether they exercise them or not, now facing a new rates bill for the first time in more than 20 years. Despite all the rhetoric about being competitive, what that proposal does in the Land Reform Bill is put Scottish businesses and farmers at a competitive disadvantage in relation to those in England and Wales, and that is not the way to help rural businesses. We welcome the proposals to reduce air passenger duty from April 2018, although we await with interest seeing what replacement tax is being proposed. So far, mostly positive, Presiding Officer. But what is equally interesting, perhaps, is what is missing from the programme. We believe that there is more that can be done on business rates. The UK Government are currently conducting a thorough review of the whole business rates regime, which could come forward with major changes for England and Wales. We know that business rates have a major impact, in particular on high street retailers, struggling with competition from the internet or out-of-town retail parks. And unlike the other business taxes, which the Finance Minister would like to get his hands on, he has full control over business rates, which indeed have been devolved since 1999. So there's no reason not to act. On the question of income tax, businesses want to know what is coming down the line from the Scottish Government when they have much greater power to vary the rates from next year. Now, we know that the Labour Party would like to see the top rate of tax increased. But there are only some 14,000 higher rate taxpayers in Scotland, many of them already doing business part of the time south of the border. And the inevitable consequence of a higher top rate of tax in Scotland would simply be a flight of wealth and capital down south, and the reduction in the tax base and in the consequent tax take. So raising the top rate of tax in Scotland would be an entirely self-defeating policy. And it would be good to know whether the SNP agree. Our view is that the Scottish rate of income tax should be set no higher than the rest of the United Kingdom. As the Scottish Retail Consortium have pointed out in their submission to the Finance Committee, any variation to income tax rates will have an impact on consumer spend and therefore the wider economy. It will also have... I will briefly, yes.
John Mason.
Would the member accept the evidence that we had at the Finance Committee that you can vary income tax rates by certainly a few percent and it really does not involve any movement?
Well, I'm relying on the evidence submitted by the Retail Consortium, who, as people in business, might know a little bit about what they are talking about. They also made the point it will impact on the ability of businesses to attract and retain talent. And businesses also need constitutional stability. Now, over the summer, there was an awful lot being said about the prospects of a second independence referendum by the current First Minister, by the former First Minister, by various SNP MPs at Westminster, by various SNP candidates and even MSPs fighting for re-selection, in some cases fighting each other for re-selection. And Scottish business needs talk of a second referendum like it needs a hole in the head. What we need is a period of constitutional stability so businesses know that we are secure within the United Kingdom. Presiding officer, next year there are more powers coming to this Parliament and more powers coming the year after. The Scottish Government's default excuse for inaction, that it does not have enough control over the levers of power, wears ever thinner. The quote, "to govern is to choose," has been attributed to various politicians in the past, but that does not make it any less true. This Government will soon have to start making choices on spending and on tax. We on these benches would give priority to growing the economy, to expanding the tax base and to improving the tax take. Yesterday's programme for government gives us only a limited vision of how the Scottish Government plans to approach these issues, and we await with interest hearing how they will take them forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. George Adam, followed by Jim Hume.
Officer, I am pleased to be part of this debate on the Scottish Government's programme for government for the coming year. Of course, as the First Minister stated yesterday, this programme is more ambitious than that. This is setting out our vision for our nation's future for years to come. There is so much within this document that is bold and exciting, but I am aware that I must stay within the parameters of the time allocated, Presiding Officer, so I will stick to a few that are important to myself. The Chamber will be aware that Glasgow International Airport is, in actual fact, in Paisley. And although not in my constituency, it is a major economic impact on our community, being one of the main employers in Renfrewshire and bringing much-needed investment. For our business to be competitive, we need to ensure that they have the opportunity to compete on a level playing field. This has been difficult for the aviation industry for some time, and I am aware that the Scottish Government has established a forum with membership for the airline industry, Scotland's airports, environmental groups and business organisations and tax professionals. This will help to ensure that this industry continues to contribute to our economy. And I, for one, also have faith in our Transport Minister for some reason or other. It is welcome that the Scottish Government will reduce the burden of APD by 50%.
Mr Malik, you can sit down. I don't think he's going to take your intervention.
When Scottish APD is introduced in 2018 with a view to abolishing it completely when resources are allowed, this is helpful because currently APD is the highest form of aviation tax in the world. Artificially depressing demand, dissuading airlines from flying to and from Scotland. Even with this major disadvantage, Glasgow International Airport has managed to be very successful in the past couple of years. Just imagine what we can achieve after 2018 that can benefit the Renfrewshire economy, or as I like to call it, Greater Paisley. I would like to at this point talk about some of the issues the First Minister brought up yesterday regarding education. Scotland's children and our young people are our greatest asset, and investing in their education is essential to achieving their aspirations and our ambitions as a country. As I have said before, Presiding Officer, since becoming a very young grandparent, it has reinforced my belief that we must ensure that our children get the same chances for personal reasons and because it is the right thing to do. The Scottish Government are taking the right steps to improve Scottish education, and we are currently seeing the results. We have a more coherent, flexible and child-focused curriculum which set higher standards for achievement than ever before, and the development and implementation of the Curriculum for Excellence. It is also heartening to hear that the next phase of Curriculum for Excellence, the Scottish Government is developing and implementing a national improvement framework for Scottish education, which sets out our vision and priorities for Scotland's children and their progress. For too long, the framework will, of course, set out the Scottish Government's vision and key priorities. But for too long, Presiding Officer, we've had a situation where it's almost we've asked our question: why? Why do children and young people from poorer areas not get the opportunities within education that others do? And I have said it before within this chamber that in my own constituency you have an east-west divide on this very situation, where you have Fergusley Park in the west, which is an area of deprivation, and Ralston in the east, which is actually a lot more affluent as well. But why, Presiding Officer? You know, my father came from Fergusley Park, and the educational attainment gap was there for generations. It's something now that I'm glad that as a Parliament and as the Scottish Government in particular are now working towards doing something about this. But not every single child. Yes, I'll take that intervention.
Would the member perhaps agree with me then that it was wrong for the Scottish Government not to give Renfrewshire Council any money from its attainment fund last year?
Mr Adam.
Mr Bibby, what do you say? The reality of the situation is, presiding officer, that Paisley, in fact two schools in Fergusley, in an area that one of the areas of worst deprivation in the whole of Scotland, St Fergus and Glencoats Primary, will be part of the attainment fund. So this is about identifying the need and making sure that we can make that difference. And that's what the framework will ensure, a forensic focus and data, obviously something Mr Bibby is not too interested in, and former approach to educational improvement at every single phase of Scottish education. We must ensure that parents and carers support and they get support in their role in their child's education. And this, for me, is a crucial area and one we must ensure that parents engage with us, because this is one of the issues that has come up time and again within the Education Committee as well. So for me, the most important aspects of all of this is that the Scottish Government wants to close the attainment gap completely. This, of course, will not happen overnight. If only it was that easy, presiding officer. My old dad, who's no longer with us, used to say, who said it was going to be easy when the family had its latest disasters? But in the real world, presiding officer, life is just not like that. But this is more about an economic and social challenge for all of us. It's a moral one as well. We must remain focused on this goal, and this Parliament must come together to see that this is our main goal and challenge for years to come. A child born today in one of our most deprived communities should, by the time he or she leaves school, have the same chance of going to university as a child born in one of our most affluent communities. But progress has been made, and it would be churlish for opposition parties to say otherwise. In 2008, just 2 in 10 students from deprived areas of Scotland obtained at least one higher or equivalent. Last year, that figure was almost 4 in 10. However, this is not far or fast enough. This programme is bold and ambitious, and I believe it's time to work together to ensure that this ambitious programme can be put forward so that Scotland truly is the best country in the world for children to grow up.
Jim Hume, followed by Christina McKelvey.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I believe we need to be more ambitious for our health service. The First Minister told us about 10,000 new staff in the NHS, mentioned the £50 million investment in the primary care fund and the £100 million investment in the mental health services. But what the First Minister didn't mention is the number of vacancies in the NHS, such as 447 vacant consultant posts, 2,255 vacant nursing and midwifery posts, and a reduction of ambulance staff since 2011 of 1,218. And only yesterday, during my member's business debate on promoting sustainable GP recruitment, I raised the issue of the crisis in our general practices in Scotland. In the words of the Royal College of General Practitioners, such as the current strain on GPs brought on by the demands placed on them and the inadequate resourcing of the service, that over a quarter of Scottish people were unable to book an appointment within a week. So, presiding officer, 42% of Scots, almost half of the population, agree that waiting times to see a GP are a national crisis. The Scottish Government, meanwhile, is putting £20 million per year in the primary care fund, where GPs don't see the benefits. Just one example of this is spending is in the GP Returner programme. And a quote and answer from the Health Secretary to one of my questions, saying that the number of GPs recruited into this programme has always been low, on average between 5 to 6 per annum. So I then question this, presiding officer, is this wise spending by the government on a programme which, for all intents and purposes, serves the right cause but makes next to zero progress in solving the crisis? After 8 years in power, we need to decide to listen the last month for the first time to what the people are actually saying and what the experts have been warning. So, presiding officer, I want to touch on the issue of also mental health, which has been a top priority for me for a long time. At the end of July, I held a summit here in this Parliament to explore what it is that really causes thousands of children and adults to wait for months on end for treatment. I wanted to hear why it is that medical trainees are reducing in numbers from mental health specialities like psychology and psychiatry, and why do health inequalities continue to be so prevalent. What I heard from the experts, the BMA, the Mental Welfare Commission and a number of the Royal Colleges, is that there is not enough support. There is not enough support for staff, patients, families of those patients, and most of all for resources. So I urge the Government in its current programme for Government to expedite the publication of the 10-year follow-up to the grant report, which was supposed to be out by the end of this summer. It was actually supposed to be out by the end of last year. The report may give us an insight into why parents of children with autism are forced to send their children in England for treatment because of a lack of inpatient beds in Scotland, or why are GPs forced to prescribe drugs instead of sending their patients to specialised evidence-based treatments, because they know that those 3,500 patients will wait more than 4.5 months to see an expert. So I'd like to know when the Scottish Government will decide to hear the repeated calls from the Liberal Democrats to establish parity of esteem in law between mental and physical health. Presiding Officer, the impact on the quality of funding places pressures on other parts of the system that have to do with mental and physical well-being. In its report, A Blueprint for Scotland's Future, the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing makes the recommendation that housing should be a full and equal partner in health and social care partnerships. This means allowing every family and household to afford the type of housing they need when they need, when they actually do need it. So there's no doubt that we've heard plans have been put in place, policies developed and strategies created, but the facts speak for themselves. The number of households turning to the private rented sector has nearly tripled in the last 15 years owing to the chronic shortage of affordable homes. The recommendation for Shelter Scotland stands at providing 10,000 new homes for social rent each year to meaningfully tackle Scotland's housing crisis. Now, the Government mentioned that they will surpass the building of 30,000 affordable homes, but that's not socially rented homes, and that wasn't what their promise in their manifesto was. It was for socially rented homes. Only about 20,000 of those have been provided in the 5 years. That's about 40% of what is actually needed. I think it's everyone has that right to have a warm, safe, permanent home for themselves. So I'm looking forward to discussing the Government's plans for the Private Tenancies Bill and how that will bring about positive change for the Scottish housing sector. So, Presiding Officer, in setting out the programme for Government, the Scottish Government must realise what the starting and ending points for the wellbeing of people in Scotland are. In doing so, they have to have prioritised the health of the population and the right to a safe, warm and permanent home. Thank you.
Thank you. We now have Christina McKelvey, followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, being a visionary and committed to a stronger, fairer Scotland is the keystone of this Government. The legislative programme ahead is ambitious and demanding, and I look forward to playing my part in it with colleagues. As the Chamber knows, I have been advocating legislative action on domestic violence and revenge porn throughout the life of this Parliament. I am therefore particularly pleased to see this coming into action, as I'm sure many of my colleagues across the Chamber are too. The fight to ban internet publication of intimate images without the consent of those depicted has been on the Scottish Government's agenda for 3 years, and I have led 2 debates on this subject. As a direct result of my close contact and support of Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland, I learned just what an extensive, important problem revenge porn has grown to become. And I hope that I am able to bring that knowledge to the attention of everyone in this chamber and have helped to raise the awareness of this gross invasion of privacy. And can I pay tribute and thanks to all of my colleagues across the chamber who have supported any of the motions I've put forward and allowed us to debate this important subject in this chamber. I really appreciate that support. Presiding Officer, this is not an issue that should divide political parties. This is about protecting people, especially young people, from having their lives destroyed by the malice of a former partner. Groups like Women's Aid have already spoken about how the publishing of images and videos that were meant to be private are used as acts of sexual abuse, often alongside intimidation and blackmail. Some victims have felt so threatened and distressed that they have contemplated and actually committed suicide. Police Scotland, I believe, will make a vital contribution to this. It is they who will apply the law, and so they need to be certain that it is workable. Their input will be sought and carefully considered, I hope, during the legislative process. And Police Scotland has already made clear to the Justice Secretary that it welcomes the proposed legislation and will work cooperatively to apply it effectively. I welcome that too. Presiding Officer, it is clearly crucial that the legislation we produce is effective and accessible, and to a certain extent I imagine the law will have a very significant deterrent effect that will make current offenders think more carefully. and I hope it will also further raise awareness of this issue. Presiding Officer, the consultations that will take place as legislation is written will address issues of precisely how best to structure this law alongside existing laws, and that is a practical and effective way to do it. The new legislation also means that we have stronger, more effective powers to eliminate domestic and sexual abuse. For far too long, men, and in most cases it is men, but I understand we do have abuse across the genders, has been able to abuse their partners with little prospect of their victims ever being able to secure a conviction. I hope we see the end of that. Presiding Officer, on a very personal note, I have to say I was delighted to see that MND sufferers will get access to the voice equipment through an amendment to the health bill. I have lobbied, as have many, including the very inspirational Gordon Aikman and MND Scotland, to build a voice library and provide voice services that make a huge difference to the quality of an MND sufferer. We very kindly, with your participation, Presiding Officer, hosted the Voice Bank in this place last year. And can I make a plea? The Voice Bank is currently on tour and they need male voices, especially those from the northeast of Scotland. So whether you're Doric or a Highlander or whatever, please get along and donate your voice to this extremely worthwhile project. The First Minister has also made it clear our powers over welfare policy and action are limited, but it is nevertheless clear that the Government intends to take action to mitigate the devastating damage already inflicted by George Osborne's cuts. While the Chancellor slightly increased the tax-free allowance, he cut back the annual income of about 200,000 Scottish households by about £3,000 a year. So, Presiding Officer, I greatly welcome a social security bill, and I'm glad it's called a social security bill, because social security is exactly what it is. George Osborne has also tried to rewrite the living wage and reduce it, but we aren't that stupid, Presiding Officer, or cynical. In Scotland, we say the living wage is exactly what it is, a wage you can live on. And as colleagues are aware, I have had a long-standing association with the trade union movement fighting for a living wage, a relationship which I am very proud of. I believe in enhancing the powers of workers have to improve their employment rights in areas like health and safety, bullying, sexual harassment, and also the very important issue of blacklisting that we seek to eliminate. That's why I'm glad to hear the Fair Work Convention is to create a new framework that will build strong, sustainable relationships between the stakeholder groups. This government, this Scottish government, will not stand idly by while the UK government tries to undermine the rights of trade unions. We will oppose it every step of the way. We work from the fundamental principle that employment has to be fair in equal terms, both in gender and pay levels. When workers are not getting a fair deal, they need to have the ability to take their employer to tribunal. But under the UK government's terms, you will have to pay £250. We don't have the power to stop this at present, but I am very pleased to see that when we do have the power, we will abolish those fees and possibly turn around the 70% plus drop in cases just in the last year. The powers that the Scottish Bill will bring us are intended far more limited than we would have liked to have seen. Presiding Officer, I want a country that doesn't turn its back on refugees. I want a country that upholds human rights. I want a country that upholds trade union rights, and I want a country that sees a social security system that actually protects our vulnerable, and I think our government have that in their legislative programme.
Jackie Bailey, followed by Stuart McMillan.
Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to debate the programme for government. There are elements of the legislative programme that I support. The Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Bill is one. Private Tenancies Bill, which we've been calling for I think the best part of a year, is another. And of course the Fiscal Commission Bill, which I repeatedly asked for last year, making sure that we get the stewardship of the nation's finances right. Our support for an independent Scottish equivalent of the Office of Budget Responsibility is hardly surprising when we have an SNP government that got it so badly wrong when making financial projections about oil revenues. We now have a situation where oil is less than $50 a barrel, where revenues are indeed at an all-time low. Recent reports show that tax receipts from the industry were £168 million for the first quarter, compared with a staggering £969 million for the same period the year before, a fraction of what the Scottish Government was relying on to make their sums add up. But this isn't some random debating point. There are very real consequences as a result of this, with the thousands of jobs already lost in the North East and indeed across Scotland. And I welcome the fact that the Energy Jobs Task Force is to continue for another 6 months. I'm genuinely not sure that that will be enough, because if I understand it correctly, their record so far of helping 12 apprenticeships whilst thousands lose their jobs is something that we need to push further forward. Indeed I will.
Kevin Stewart.
I wonder if Ms Bailey would agree with me that one of the things which could help job security in the North Sea Basin is if the Chancellor of the Exchequer introduced a tax incentive for exploration, and then we could see the likes of what's happened in Norway with much more drilling.
Yeah, I do indeed agree with the member, but I'm actually looking at what in the programme for government the Scottish Government can do. And I think if we got both governments working in concert, you know, actually focused on the North Sea, then we would see some substantial help being put in place. So we need, in my view, an independent fiscal commission. We need it to have a comprehensive range of powers. But it is more important than ever, because for the first time in April, we will be able to set a Scottish rate of income tax. Now, we know that just as important as the laws that you pass are the things that you do in government, how you spend your money, how that signals your priorities. And can I join with Christina McKelvey at this point in congratulating Gordon Aitken in securing support from the government for voice equipment for those with MND? And I commend the government for taking that approach. First Minister, in a statement yesterday, talked about an economic plan, and I welcome the focus on growing our economy, the recognition that the strategy set out in March needed much more detail and a clear plan for implementation. We will, of course, be debating that next week, and I expect John Swinney to make the case for a greater reliance on onshore tax receipts now that the price of oil has plummeted. Interestingly, the programme for government restated the commitment to full fiscal autonomy as the SNP's preferred position, short of independence. Problem is, the sums didn't add up when John Swinney first suggested it, and despite all the name changes, it still doesn't add up now. So whether the SNP like it or not, it is a fact that public spending is £1,300 higher per person in Scotland than the UK average. That reflects the choices we make based on our priorities. So let me say as gently as I can to the Deputy First Minister. When Labour started in government in 1999, our spending on health and education as a proportion of our budget was higher than in England. When we left office in 2007, our spending on health and education as a proportion of our budget was higher than in England. The SNP inherited that. But now we spend a smaller proportion of our budget on health and education than they do in England. That's the legacy from the SNP. We now spend less on education and health than even the Tories do. In health, we see that £1 billion has been stripped out of the GP budget. We have a crisis in recruiting GPs and consultants. Vacancies are increasingly hard to fill. And for all that we have integration of health and social care, our social services are creaking at the seams. Little said about them in the programme for government. I don't have time. The renewed focus on education is welcome. But after 8 years, the SNP's record speaks for itself. A 12% gap in reading for P7s between the most and least deprived, 21% gap in writing, 24% gap in numeracy, an attainment gap that hasn't changed in 8 years, 4,000 fewer teachers, 140,000 fewer college places. That's not investing in our young people or in our economy. So education is to be the new priority for the SNP. If that's the case, they should put their money where their mouth is. Their £100 million attainment fund, albeit welcome, has been announced several times. It averages £25 million a year. Yesterday, they said that they would take £250 million away by abolishing air passenger duty. What does that tell you about the SNP's priorities? Surely, presiding officer, it is not the case that they would much rather give us cheap holidays abroad than invest in our children's future. The programme for government is a sleight of hand that points towards the election and beyond, hoping that the people of Scotland won't notice your abysmal record.
Stuart McMillan, followed by John Finney.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. There is much to commend and welcome from yesterday's statement by the First Minister, and I'm going to touch upon a couple of them. But first of all, I actually want to thank the First Minister and the Transport Minister for the fabulous news on Monday when it was announced that Ferguson Marine in Port Glasgow was the preferred bidder to build the next two Seamill ferries worth £97 million. I also want to thank the former First Minister, Alex Salmond, for his pivotal role in saving the yard last year, which has ensured that Monday's fantastic news could have happened. Now, members of my party will know of my long history of raising the issue of shipbuilding and lobbying to bring work to what was Ferguson's, even before I was elected. And I have maintained that since I've been an MSP, because I knew that shipbuilding on the Lower Clyde could actually have a future, and Monday's announcement actually proves this to be the case. This will actually take the number of ships awarded to Ferguson's by this Scottish Government to 5, and shows that the reindustrialisation of the Lower Clyde is an SNP commitment being delivered. And Monday's announcement is also brilliant news for Inverclyde. It's also a real vote of confidence in the area, and it can give a significant boost to the local economy, create jobs, and continue the West of Scotland's justified reputation as a leader in the shipbuilding industry, and shows that commercial shipbuilding in Scotland has a bright and prosperous future ahead of it. Since 2007, a key target of this government has been in creating a more successful country with opportunities for all of Scotland to flourish through increasing economic growth. And a strong, vibrant and diverse economy is essential to our national prosperity and helps to create the wealth needed to support the high-quality public services, such as our commitment to deliver on the NHS budget of over £12 billion for this particular year. And one of the best ways that we can actually help people to help themselves is through giving them access to the best possible education. Now, excellence in education is essential to our prosperity, competitiveness, well-being, to overall success as a nation in the future as well. And in the last 8 years, they have been tough with the recession and also the financial impact that has had upon Scotland's economy and Scotland's budget from Westminster's cuts. But the fact remains that education in Scotland has actually made progress. There's been the introduction of the Curriculum for Excellence, and that has been a major step forward. 520 schools have been rebuilt or refurbished since 2007, and that's more than one in five of the school premises in the country. And it's also 200 more than in the previous 8 years. We provided funding to maintain teacher numbers, and in 2006, more than 15,000 Primary 1 children were in classes of more than 25. Now that figure is below 500. And as a result of the SNP government's investment in education, we are seeing better outcomes than ever before. School labour destinations are the best on record, and of the students who left school last year, more than 9 out of 10 were in employment, education or training 9 months later. And this year, young people in Scotland gained a higher record number of passes at higher and advanced higher. In every part of the country, Scotland has good schools, good teachers, and young people are good learners, and standards have risen and are continuing to rise. And while we know school education in Scotland is getting better, with record exam results and a record number of school leavers in work, education and training, we have long recognised attainment as being an important area where improvement is needed. And the new Scottish Attainment Challenge will play a key role in driving that work, with a fund of over £100 million to be invested over 4 years. From January, an additional 22,000 16 to 19-year-olds will be eligible for the education maintenance allowance, which is in stark contrast to the Westminster government, who removed EMAs from England only a number of years ago. And also placing kinship care on the same financial support as foster carers is a welcome announcement. But throughout the process of the Smith Commission and the Scotland Bill, the SNP has consistently argued that more powers over the economy and social security it should be transferred to Scotland in order to allow stronger action to tackle poverty and inequality, including full devolution of the social security system and powers over the minimum wage. And clearly, the Scotland Bill doesn't go as far as I would want it to go or my party would want it to go, but nevertheless, I welcome the announcement of a new Social Security Bill post the 2016 election if we are re-elected. And as co-convener of the cross-party group on funerals and bereavement, I welcome the First Minister's announcement of the Burial and Cremation Bill. Now, some of the members of the CPG were actually members of the Burial and Cremation Review Group, and they kept us fully informed of the progress of that and also of the Lord Bonamy Commission. Another point from yesterday was that the commitment regarding the Small Business Bonus Scheme, and that this Small Business Bonus Scheme has been an essential lifeline to local businesses the length and breadth of Scotland. and the commitment to keep this scheme until the end of the next Parliament will be warmly welcomed by the small business community. And I know of a few who have actually kept their doors open in recent years because of this scheme, and I'm sure that they will also be delighted. And also the commitment to reduce the APD. And I mean, for me, I mean, as chair of the cross-party group on recreational boating and marine tourism, I know that this particular sector will actually benefit from this, because there's a third of the berths in Scotland that have been taken up from people who live in the southeast of England. Then this actually might encourage them to come up to Scotland a bit more often and spend even more money when they come here. But to conclude with, presiding officer, this Scottish Government ambition for radical reform remains undiminished, and this programme for government for the next year sets out the policies and legislation that will build upon all that we have achieved so far and establish a springboard to the future in education, fairness and industry. And I warmly welcome it, and I'm sure that the people of Scotland will warmly welcome it also. Thank you.
John Finney, followed by Chick Brodie.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. There's much to be commended about the Government's programme for the coming year, not least the workers' rights, and I very much welcome the abolition of employment tribunal fees. The imposition of these fees had the desired effect, as we've heard, with a 70% reduction, and I would agree with the First Minister that this was, and I quote, a very positive early use of powers. Similarly, I welcome the information about the gender gap information and the reduced threshold for that. I commend the fact that the Scottish Government does support the 50-50 by 2020 campaign, but that must apply across the public sector, and it was only yesterday in Justice Committee that I was raising that issue in relation to the composition of the Scottish Sentencing Council. Now, I commend collaborative work across the Chamber and both within and out with the Chamber, and the Fair Work Convention as an example of that. Also mentioned in the programme is developing our young workforce, and the issue of a per-head payment for training rather than a payment to providers that reflects the costs incurred must be looked at again. The use of language is very important, and again, I commend the use of words partners, not opponents. And we see an opportunity for unity in a large section of the Chamber around the issues of the Trade Union Bill and the Lobbying Bill, and I welcome the Labour Party's positive approach to that. The private tenancies, the Living Rent campaign, many people in the Chamber, myself included, have been involved in that to a small extent, and that's a significant issue across the country and particularly in the Highlands and Islands. Welcome the abolition of the bedroom tax, and I'm delighted that the Scottish Government included in the programme the comment that greater equality is good for economic growth. That is the case. The Rural Housing Fund is to be commended, but of course that's not without its challenges too, because access to land to build those very houses is a challenge. Now, I took the opportunity to stop and speak out with the Parliament this morning to our land campaign, and they've sent us all a list of what I think are very modest and reasonable requests that we follow, and they say what we are asking you to do is, number one, reinstate the requirement for all landowning entities, like companies, to be registered in a member state of the EU. I'll not go through the full list, but I will go to the fourth one, which is acknowledge that this land reform bill won't solve the problem of unaffordable and unavailable land in Scotland, and prepare to adopt further measures in the next Parliament to tackle land taxation, lack of information about land ownership, derelict and vacant land, absentee lordism and exorbitant costs of land for housing. And I hope that in future we'll see some unity about that. The planning review is welcome, but it's not just the review for the sake of it. I'm interested to know what consequences there could be, for instance, for the Gypsy Traveller community, who have long been neglected in the process, whether there will be issues about their tenancy that we've been assured will be addressed. And similarly, with the investment of £60 million in primary care, is that going to enhance the life expectancy already much lower for the Gypsy Traveller community? Well, I would hope so, but we remain to see the evidence of that. The programme talks about, the First Minister's statement said, the success of our economy is essential to all our aims. The real northern powerhouse is the aspiration. We will do this not by a race to the bottom. We will continue to support our oil and gas industry. Now, it's certainly the view of members in this area of the Chamber that the way you would support that is a just transition to a low-carbon economy. And I'd like to commend the Jobs in Scotland's New Economy report by Mika Minoa-Panuela. And that outlines the fact that we have 470 platforms in the North Sea, 10,000 kilometres of pipelines, 5,000 wells that will need to be decommissioned over the next 30 years. And the cost over the next decade is estimated at £14.6 billion. Now, that's not an estimate by the Scottish Green Party. That's an estimate by Oil and Gas UK. And that rises to £40 billion by 2040. Indeed, Shell's enormous Brent Delta platform has partially been dismantled this year and shipped to Teesside. 97% of that will be recycled. And indeed, it would take 12 years to dismantle the entire Brent oil field. And that would require 1,000 offshore workers alone. So there is an opportunity, and that opportunity is for the Scottish Government to position Aberdeen as a global centre of decommissioning skills. And that could be linked to the failed climate change targets. And I acknowledge the baseline change. I acknowledge the UK Government's cynical policy shift. But keeping doing the same is not going to change things. And air passenger duty is one aspect of that. We heard from Stuart McMillan how he's looking forward to the increased flow of people to be involved in recreational sailing. Well, I too would welcome that, but I would hope they would sail here or take the train here, because of course there will be modal shift if you reduce the costs, and we must look at... yes, indeed.
I thank Mr Finney for taking the intervention. The reason why I said what I said earlier is because a third of the people who actually birth in Scotland do actually live in the south-east of England. So certainly some may want to travel by train, but also others might actually want to fly.
Can I
commend the very excellent cross-border rail services that do exist, and I would hope you would commend them too. There's mention in the programme about investment hubs. I would like to see investment comment about goods rail hubs. A city the size of Dundee doesn't have a goods rail hub. If Invergordon had one, then the linkage with decommissioning is very clear. And in response to a parliamentary question, I was told that this wasn't a government matter. Well, of course it's a government matter. We must work together. There's a lot to commend itself. No mention of Gaelic, no mention of drugs. But certainly the mitigation that's going to the UK Government's welfare reform could be much better spent. So there's a lot to commend it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Finney. Chick Brodie, followed by Graeme Pearce.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome the programme for government for the coming year. In my first speech, Presiding Officer, in this chamber, I suppose inevitably drew on my own experience in industry, and I spoke of the need for manufacturing, making products and providing services that the international community needed and wanted. But before I address that specifically, may I welcome the government's reconfirmation to reduce APD by 50% by April 2018 and to extend the operation of our four enterprise areas. That can only be very good news for Prestwick and Ayrshire. It's instructive when I hear all the comments about APD that Michael O'Leary of Ryanair said APD is the most insanely stupid tax ever introduced by any government, and that's probably why Holland and Ireland got rid of it after only 1 year's implementation.
John Finney.
The member would maybe like to tell us a tax that Mr O'Leary does approve of, please.
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
The member would maybe like to tell us a tax that Mr O'Leary does approve of.
Chick Brodie.
Well, he certainly doesn't approve of APD, understandably. Now that, along with other enterprise initiatives, will spur us on to, I believe, growth and jobs. The combination of strengthening Scotland's manufacturing base, the support for the Innovation Challenge Fund, a new trade and investment strategy focusing on international export aspirations and our inward investment ambitions are and will be the springboard to create the wealth which we wish to see distributed fairly. And we'll also see the capitalisation of our resources, the greatest of which, of course, is the will and the skills of the Scottish people. Now, I don't want to rehearse all the points on education, because a lot of that has been made by several of my colleagues, but the development of skills is definitely a key strategic input to our economy, an important, if not the important, component to our competitiveness and productivity. Presiding Officer, I make no apology for applauding the proposals to encourage business and commercial growth, to encourage more and growing small and medium-sized businesses to consider internationalisation and innovation and partnership as routes to growth. That will necessitate our agencies, all our agencies and finance institutions, to help such companies access the seed finance to allow them to grow, to innovate and to internationalise. That growth will be further accommodated by the creation and establishment of new innovation and investment hubs in London, Brussels and Dublin to augment the work already done by SDI in the international community with outposts in the likes of America, Asia, and it will also help the platform of the Global Scots Network. These linkages will be crucial to build the connectivity and the networks to achieve the programmes stated for international growth, as indeed will the plans for our digital infrastructure. We should harness the experience, I believe, of those that have already performed successfully in the role of international marketing or finance or sales or manufacturing to aid and abet those small and medium-sized businesses adopt an internationally competitive ethos. The significant programme made toward the Scottish Government's target to increase exports by 50% by 2017 is laudable, but hides the fact that only around 100 large companies account for 60% of Scottish exports. We have to, and I believe the programme certainly promotes this, we have to ensure that exporting and internationalisation of our businesses is in the DNA of every Scottish manufacturing and service company, and that our agencies can monitor these outcomes within the National Performance Framework to secure the indication of the number of businesses capable of exporting. Presiding Officer, innovation is important. Partnership is important. But above all, our international competitiveness and importance will depend on our productivity. That means a greater marrying, I believe, of capital and labour. And I would seek that we welcome and propose the Manufacturing Action Plan, that it considers how we can affect greater equity and democratic participation in the workplace to secure the high-wage, high-productivity economy that we need, where investment and the depreciation of new productive capital equipment is denied because of a lower-wage economy. Presiding Officer, it was Bill Clinton who said in a run-up to an election, he said, it's the economy, stupid. Yesterday, the First Minister said, the success of our economy is essential, essential to all of our aims. So it is.
Thank you. Graham Pearson, to be followed by Alex Johnson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I will obviously comment on the programme for government from the particular aspect of the justice portfolio I represent. But if I can be allowed to make a more general comment to begin, the First Minister spoke of her desire yesterday to close the attainment gap between children in the most and least deprived areas. Can I remind government ministers that with drugs death trends on the rise and a substantial growth in the numbers of chaotic drug abusers, unless the government makes progress with substance abuse, whether it be drugs or alcohol, there will still be children who are left behind, children who are living in chaotic households with adults who are abusing drugs and or alcohol. So test children when they get to school, but the support families really need in closing attainment gaps can often start even before they arrive at school. This SNP government has an unenviable record of having lost, and some outside this chamber would say abandoned, its convener of the Scottish Police Authority, followed by the Chief Constable in a matter of weeks, whilst at the same time policing as an authority has become immersed in controversy. I therefore welcome yesterday's announcement from the First Minister that there is a need to learn from experience and make improvements where necessary, even if that acknowledgement comes after many months and indeed years of hostile rejection of any lessons, both from ministers and many SNP backbenchers. The closure of control rooms, arming of police and routine patrols, stop search debacle were all vehemently defended by the government month after month. It is a relief, quite honestly, to hear what I presume is a shift in position and a change of tone, and I take it as a clear acknowledgement that the penny has dropped. I hope, too, yesterday's speech brings about an end to the hostilities that as we move forward to deliver a truly world-class police service, a target I'm sure we all agree with. I therefore welcome the First Minister's announcement of changes in the expectations of the Scottish Police Authority under a new convener. I hope the Cabinet Secretary has the courage to ensure the authority stands tall in its role of delivering effective governance and accountability. It would be helpful if tomorrow the Cabinet Secretary further develops that change in approach in his statement. The mea culpa implicit in the acknowledgement of a need for an enhancement of local community accountability is also welcome. However, I must say an occasional visit from a Chief Constable to such events is no replacement for the candid exchange of information at the local level in response to diligent questioning raised from within the communities. Only then will we begin to develop a police service of truly world class. In addition, I trust the Cabinet Secretary will deliver on his promise to consider a right of audience for local panel conveners to be heard at the National Policing Authority when issues are unresolved through the normal channels. The commitment to implement the recommendations from the HMIC reports again are welcome. The move towards a statutory code of practice on stop and search, though inevitable, is the result we should remember of the blind commitment from police chiefs to deliver targets and results at odds with community expectations, evidence in itself of the need for effective oversight. It is a pity, and perhaps an oversight, that the government did not think to extend the review of policing to encompass also the fire and rescue services, an area of public reform all but overlooked in the scheme of things. All emergency services need not only our support and thanks, but also deserve our attention in terms of ensuring a healthy culture exists within organisations conducive to good public service. And the fire service has undergone a tremendous reform in the past couple of years, as we have witnessed within the police service also. The legislation in respect of revenge porn, like the enhancements of domestic abuse protections through laws, are both timely and welcomed on this side of the chamber. Though I do identify with the comments made earlier with Malcolm Chisholm, as is the government's commitment to the delivery of a lobbying bill, legislation so ably advocated by Neil Findlay on our benches, and also welcome the introduction of a commitment to workers' rights in the years ahead. It has been a difficult time for this chamber in dealing with reforms, and I would hope that the Cabinet Secretary, supported by the government, will move forward in a positive frame in support of all of us who would seek to see a fairer Scotland. Thanks very much, President.
Thank you, Alex Johnson. To be followed by Willie Coffey.
And to be finished as quick as I can, Presiding Officer. There's an often used practice in politics that if you say a thing often enough, it begins to get perceived as true. And here we are. We have heard the First Minister yesterday, and we've had the Cabinet Secretary, Alec Neil, earlier today, telling us about the fact that this government is going to hit its target for building affordable housing. But we've already had that pointed out by Jim Hume in his speech earlier, that of course the commitment that was made in the manifesto in advance of the last election was to build 30,000 socially rented houses during the course of this parliament. And that was very quickly revised after the election to be 30,000 affordable homes, of which 20,000 would be socially rented. So the fact is that when ministers stand up and claim that they're going to hit that target, if they look very carefully at their own words, their own commitments, then they'll discover that they're going to miss that target by a full 10,000. They're going to miss that target by a full third. And that's only consistent with this government, given that during their previous term,
2007 to 2011, budgets year on year seem to target the housing budget as an area where huge cuts could be made, disproportionate cuts could be made, and they hoped nobody would notice. The result of this practice is that we have become, over the last 8 years and more, progressively more dependent on the private rented sector to provide homes for rent in Scotland. It's only to be expected, therefore, that the government would bring forward a proposal for a private tenancies bill. During the course of the consultation on that bill, I met and spoke to many representative organisations who pursue the interests of landlords. And I reassured them that they should participate in that consultation constructively, because I believed, as I do now, that there are people in this government who can count. Well, there's the Finance Minister at least. And the effect is that if you make a reasoned argument, they will understand and they will ensure that the legislation suits purpose. There's no question that there's room for improvement in the private rented sector tenancies, but there is a very real danger that the SNP, invariably a hostage to one pressure group or another, will cause further damage to the private rented sector and its investment levels with rent controls if they are introduced. Rent control, rent ceilings or rent regulation has a long history of being a politically favoured policy and is often championed as a social justice cause at times when we're undergoing financial restraint. Rent control addresses another growing issue in that has emerged by, as a byproduct of the end of local council house building, namely the cost of housing benefits. With the end of council house building, the state shifted from bricks and mortar support to financial support, and therefore increasing the costs in the market have led to increasing housing benefit bills. In Scotland, housing benefit has risen by 20% in real terms from 2003-04 to 2012-13 and now costs £1.8 billion a year. Approximately 21% of those receiving housing benefit live within the private rented sector, almost 100,000 households. The cost of accommodating someone in the private rented sector is approximately 39% higher than in the social housing with average weekly housing benefit awards being £89 a week in the private sector compared with £64 a week in the social rented sector. However, there is, I would like to develop my argument if you don't mind. The problem is that history tells us that rent controls don't work. In many cases, Swedish economist Assar Lindbeck said that in many cases, rent control appears to be the most effective technique presently known to destroy a city, except for bombing it. In 1992, a survey of American and Canadian economists found that 93% agreed with the statement that a ceiling on rents reduces the quantity and quality of housing available. By capping rents, you increase the demand and you can cause divestment by the sector, creating a shortage in the market. This shortage makes it more difficult for renters to find properties in rent-controlled areas, often leading to those in rented accommodation staying longer in their property, further reducing the availability of supply. Landlords also become more selective in their choice of tenants, which means that those on lower incomes, which rent control was meant to assist, are actually excluded from the market.
You need to bring your remarks to a close.
The fact is that rent control in any form artificially caps the potential return from an asset, and this restriction can discourage investment into a sector at a time when investment to address housing demand is much needed. You cannot legislate your way out of a housing crisis. You can only build your way out of it. Let's build houses.
Willie Coffey, followed by Mary Fee.
Presiding Officer, thank you very much. Over the summer, I had the privilege of visiting the Laighkirk Mission in Kilmarnock to see for myself the good work being done there by the churches in the town to help some of our poorest and disabled citizens. We had the homeless, we had people trying to get into a recovery programme, people with disabilities, people trying to avoid reoffending, and people just dropping in for some support and perhaps a hot meal. Some hadn't eaten a proper meal for days, and you could easily tell those who were too proud to even admit that they were in such dire circumstances. They arrive at the mission slightly suspicious about the motives and intent of their hosts, and for a while at least kept a safe distance from any close contact or interaction that might expose their plight in front of others whom they didn't know and probably didn't trust. This, Presiding Officer, is a brief glimpse into what is happening in modern Scotland to some of our most vulnerable people. Those people I met didn't choose those outcomes as a career option. Through a variety of circumstances, they have found themselves in need of help. But at the same time, they have become the victims of a callous and uncaring government whose purpose is to save money at their expense and to balance its books, no matter the human cost and no matter the damage that's done. A government that deliberately drives more of its poorest citizens further into poverty will surely stand condemned by any reasonable person who aspires to live in a caring society. However, within all that adversity, there are some wonderful people who are helping to turn those lives around. Mainly staffed by volunteers and with the assistance of health professionals and council expertise, there is an incredible range of good work going on. From smoking cessation to housing and tenancy advice, helpful advice and form filling to cooking demonstrations of the most basic and inexpensive meals that even I could follow. It was a heartening experience to see this, and it set the context for what I was hoping I might hear in the First Minister's statement yesterday when she announced her plans to introduce the Scottish Social Security Bill. Of course, we need to deal as best we can with the circumstances such as those presented by people coming to that mission for help. But I hope we would rather intervene earlier and prevent people from falling into poverty in the first place. And surely to goodness, no caring government would want to engineer the type of conditions that actually drive people into poverty with the consequent damage that this causes. We can't go on treating the symptoms of poverty if one government deliberately sets out to make it worse. So it was with great pride that I listened to the First Minister when she said that her government would stand against a government that imposes austerity on the vulnerable while preparing to spend billions of pounds renewing Trident. Our Social Security Bill, as economist Mike Danson said, can create the basis for addressing some of the evils being inflicted on the poorest in our society. It can be the framework that will allow us to make provision for those early but limited policy changes that are coming down the line. We can set the groundwork to get rid of the bedroom tax, a blatant piece of money grabbing from the poor, if ever there was one, not even with the pretence of tying it to wider housing policy or housing supply. The bill hopes to improve how the system will support disabled people and their carers and will change the universal credit arrangements to help people manage their money better, restoring dignity and respect where those have been largely abandoned under the current system. The DWP's work programme is not designed to help people overcome barriers to work. It does nothing to try and prevent people from becoming long-term unemployed, and so it will be replaced by April 2017. There are a number of other important measures in the programme for government that also support these important principles. The £100 million investment in mental health services, particularly for children and adolescents. The commitment to increase financial support for kinship carers to the same level as foster carers is very welcome. And a small but important commitment is in there to assist people with funeral payments who may run into debt while organising a funeral for their loved ones. Presiding Officer, my hope is that this bill can be a model for a society that truly cares about its most disadvantaged citizens. I hope it embeds at its heart the kind of compassion and respect that in themselves will allow people like those in the mission in Kilmarnock to recover the hope and respectability that have been taken from them, and to move forward in their lives in the knowledge that their government in Scotland cares enough about them to help them through the most challenging times in their lives. I'm delighted, as the last speaker from my group, to commend the First Minister for announcing this bill, and I look forward with eagerness to its early implementation. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I now call on Mary Fee, after which we'll move to the closing speeches over this two-day debate, and just take this opportunity to remind members that all of those who have taken part in this debate over the preceding 2 days should be with us for those closing speeches. Mary Fee, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, Kezia Dugdale remarked on the positive impact that the three leaders of Scotland's main parties are expected to have on our country, and the duty placed on each to deliver material change and equality for women. And I'd like to echo those comments by welcoming the announcements made by the First Minister on further childcare to allow both mothers and fathers back to work, on action to tackle domestic abuse, rape and revenge porn, and in tackling unequal pay imposed on women in the workplace. On childcare, the First Minister said that by 2020, her aim is to expand provision to 1,100 hours a year. This is a significant increase, one I and parents will welcome if it is delivered, remembering that this is almost double of what was only recently been achieved by the Scottish Government, 8 years on from their last pledge of 600 hours to Scottish families. In 2013, at the Scottish Women's Conference in Dynamic Earth, the First Minister called on childcare to be viewed as part of our infrastructure, an aspiration I fully support. And to ensure that this is the case, we must look at extending provision as well as flexibility and additional costs. Presiding Officer, no woman should live in fear of abuse, rape, or indeed of intimate moments captured on camera being shared with others. A society that can tackle these abuses is a society that we embrace for all women. We know that more action can be taken, and as Kezia Dugdale said yesterday, we will support the Scottish Government where we can. This is just one example of that cooperation that we can and must offer. Tackling gender inequality in the workplace has long been the ambition of successive governments, both in Scotland and in the United Kingdom. Since Barbara Castle passed the Equal Pay Act of 1970 under Harold Wilson's Labour government. Yesterday, the First Minister rightly announced that over the next year, she will extend the duty on public authorities to publish information about the gender pay gap by reducing the threshold. And this is a further step in the morally right direction. But I know, as well as the First Minister does, that we can go further, and Scottish Labour will help to set the agenda to tackle low pay in all sectors across Scotland. On the living wage, the First Minister aptly referred to it as the real living wage. And what George Osborne is proposing is a con for people on low pay and discriminatory to younger workers. The living wage rate must be independently set, and the cynical rebranding of the real living wage by the Chancellor is nothing more than a political opportunity. The First Minister also set out her stall on next year's Holyrood elections with a renewed focus on education. Unfortunately, this does come too late for the generation at school now, with literacy and numeracy standards falling. Educational inequality is a shame that stains our nation, but more so this SNP government, who for over 8 years have presided over failing standards in our classrooms, fewer teachers and restricted resources. The records on colleges... No, I'd like to make some progress, please. The record on colleges is dismal, and no First Minister should proclaim this to be a record to be proud of when there are 140,000 fewer college pupils, meaning young people, and those wishing to retrain lose out on opportunities afforded to many when Labour were in power. To tackle the failures in attainment, the First Minister proposes new national assessments. And I wholly welcome reducing the attainment gap, but I do share the concerns of education unions that such proposals could lead to the reintroduction of league tables. Jack McConnell deservedly scrapped them before, and the current First Minister must assure this chamber that new national assessments must not be a means to undermine teachers, head teachers and local authorities. As Chris Keats of NAS UWT said, there is nothing intrinsically wrong with testing. It already takes place in schools across Scotland. It's the use to which the tests will be put that is the problem. So we as a chamber must work with the government to ensure that the proposals posed by the First Minister are not league tables by the back door. And presiding officer, along with my colleagues in the Scottish Labour benches, we are proud of our trade unions and the work they carry out each and every day on behalf of their members. As a trade unionist and former shop steward who sat on the STUC General Council and the USDAW executive, the attacks on our unions by the Tory government are an attack on all workers. Our workers need representation, and any attempt to gag the unions must be stopped. And I welcome the opposition of the First Minister and the Scottish Government to the anti-trade union proposals of the UK Government. And I can assure this chamber that I will work with all colleagues committed to ensuring workers' rights are protected, enhanced and promoted. And finally, presiding officer, the Private Tenancies Bill is to be welcomed, despite the opportunity for action to be taken in previous years and specifically in the recent Housing Bill. It has been and will remain to be Scottish Labour position that we act to control rent rises and ensure that young people, families, the elderly and tenants of all ages and all walks of life are not ripped off by rogue landlords making unjust increases in the cost of living. Thank you.
Many thanks. And as we move to the closing speeches, I would once again invite all those members who took part in this debate over the last 2 days to join us for the closing speeches. I now call on Alison Johnston. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With my colleague Patrick Harvey, I welcome the Government's intention to invest in measures to tackle inequality and where they oppose Westminster's ongoing austerity. A Scottish social security system that helps people cope with life's challenges when they happen is sorely needed. Rent controls are warmly welcomed. This is a cost of living issue that's really important to many of my constituents. Rent controls in areas of extortionate rent and longer, more secure tenancies will help put people in control of their lives and is an important foundation needed to lead a successful life. People's rented properties need to feel like home. We welcome the proposals on domestic abuse and revenge porn. We welcome the intention to abolish employment tribunal fees. And I also welcome the commitment to oppose anti-union legislation. Surely a confident, employee-friendly government would never entertain such an idea. And employment should, at the very least, strive to be a partnership, a fair one, where people are fairly paid for the work they do. Patrick Harvey called George Osborne's so-called living wage con artistry that everyone can see. And in a fair partnership, nobody would be paid a wage that forces them into poverty or hardship. Scotland should have a quality jobs-rich economy built on decent work. Our Jobs in the New Economy report sets out the potential for creating thousands of good jobs with a move from austerity to investment and a focus on the industries of the future. I've always seen micro and small businesses as the resilient foundation of Scotland's creativity and communities, and I'll follow closely the impact of the government's proposals in this regard because it's really time to recognise the often overlooked contribution these businesses make to society, to our high streets, to the economy. I welcome the government's putting kinship carers on a par with foster carers. This will make it far more likely that children can live with grandparents, aunts and uncles who might not have been able to afford to do so, even when that was in the best interest of the child. On land reform, we must see the proposed bill strengthened if we really do aspire to a more democratic system of land ownership. When first proposed, many people were hopeful that we'd finally see some genuine positive change, particularly when the Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, at the launch of the land reform consultation, spoke of a democratically accountable and transparent system of land rights that promotes fairness, social justice, environmental sustainability
and economic prosperity. The initial consultation included the requirement that any corporate entity who wanted to own land in Scotland was registered in an EU member state, and I'd be grateful if we could hear in closing why this has been dropped. I hope too that the planning system review gives a voice to the many communities who feel steamrollered by local development plans adopted across Lothian. The Government's programme contains little mention of climate change and no answer for all those who are demanding that underground coal gasification be added to the current moratorium on unconventional gas extraction, and that that moratorium be upgraded to a permanent ban, giving communities confidence that the Government is putting their interests above that of oil company shareholders. In closing, I'd be grateful if the Minister could address this issue. And then I and others can then pass on the good news to the tens of hundreds of people who are writing in to ask us all to do just that. The Government will know that the EIS, education leaders and many parents are opposed to a return to high-stakes national testing. And I'm sure the Government is looking at what works and will know that the much-lauded Finnish education system has focused on equity, flexibility, creativity, teacher professionalism and trust. High-stakes testing and externally determined learning standards hasn't been part of that Finnish policy, that success. And the EIS tell us it's assessment for learning which has to be central, not to feed the statistics machine that is so beloved of some media and some politicians. And while this issue has been much discussed, we must look at all the issues that affect the attainment gap. Attainment is affected when teachers don't have enough specialist support for learners with additional support needs, or ongoing access to high-quality CPD and the time to access it. We know from Siobhan McMahon's recent PQ that while a fifth of the school population is identified as having additional support needs, additional support for learners has dropped markedly by more than 10%. And I'm sure we can only imagine the impact that this is having on attainment and on the well-being of pupils, parents and teachers. Parents and carers are our children's first teachers, and those early years are recognised as being critical when it comes to attainment. And I hope that the National Strategic Forum for Adult Learning will result in appropriate investment in this too often overlooked service, and look at the calls made in the Manifesto for Adult Learning. We all, I am sure, welcome the increase in the hours of nursery provision for our youngest children. But this isn't only an issue of quantity. This is about the quality of those hours. And I support, with others, Save the Children's calls for further investment in the early learning and childcare workforce and in strengthening support for parents. All those involved in childcare should be paid the living wage and be supported to maintain quality. All those involved in all sorts of care should be paid the living wage. And investment in primary care and social care are essential to decreasing the strain on our acute services. Presiding Officer, there are too many subjects to cover in depth in the time I have, but the Green Group will continue to work constructively with the Government whenever we can, and if we are critical, our criticism will be constructive. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Liam MacArthur. 6 minutes, please, Mr MacArthur.
Thank you very much. Can I start with an apology for my late arrival in the Chamber this afternoon, though I, looking around, may not be the only one in that position. Presiding Officer, earlier this year, the First Minister made a speech at the LSE in which she argued that the Government's records should be, quote, opened up to proper scrutiny. She meant, of course, the UK Government's record, but the principle is sound, particularly with a Government that has been in power now for over 8 years. Sadly, too often the Scottish Government eludes such scrutiny. Too often outlandish promises are made by ministers whose failure then to deliver, as a number of members have observed, is either ignored, rewritten or blamed on someone else, usually Westminster, though increasingly councils are finding that life after the death of the historic Concordat is pretty unforgiving. With the First Minister determined to keep outflanking Labour on the left and the Tories heading right, I believe that scrutiny must also reflect the desire of many in Scotland to see politics anchored in the centre, economic discipline allied to social justice, creating opportunity for all. That is what Liberal Democrats will provide. With regard to this programme for government, the First Minister invited us to look forward. That's fair, but we also need honesty about where we are now. And as Willie Rennie highlighted yesterday, in key areas, that honesty, a willingness to accept that critics are not talking anyone down, but rather pointing out that things are not as they are being portrayed, that is lacking. Of course, there are areas where we fully support what the First Minister had to say yesterday, steps to address failures exposed by the Morton Hall Babies Ashes scandal, the establishment of a new right to voice equipment for those who need it, responding to the tireless and dignified campaigning led by Gordon Aikman, and the promise of equality in treatment of kinship carers, all worthy of support. And I thought Christina McKelvey, Jackie Bailey, Mary Fee and others spoke passionately about the measures to tackle domestic abuse and revenge porn, another example where we will surely find common cause. There are many areas, though, where even if we agree on the principles, we do not agree with the government's approach. And as Jackson Carlaw observed yesterday, democracy is ill-served when agreement can only be reached on the SNP's terms. In justice, for example, Willie Rennie set out vividly where this government has got it wrong, badly wrong. These failings, as Graham Pearson observed this afternoon, have been ignored and dismissed month after month. Even now, Nicola Sturgeon and our Justice Secretary talk of the positive legacy of the departing Chief Constable and successful implementation of police centralisation. This view is delusional. Not for now, John. It is certainly not one shared by rank-and-file officers, nor increasingly by the wider public. And little wonder. A charge sheet of armed police on our streets, industrial stop and search, call centre closures, the recent tragedy on the M9, the allegations of illegal spying, hardly the positive legacy which the SNP demands we salute. Officers and civilian staff are doing their level best to deliver, but they and the public will be dismayed at the First Minister's failure to face up to the reality of a botched centralisation. They and the public expect better of their government. Alison MacInnes has put forward proposals to address the problems in Police Scotland and the SPA. The SNP's review need to take these on board. Not for now, Mr Stewart. Similarly on health, it's not a condemnation of doctors, nurses or other staff working in our NHS to point out to the problems that exist. They are often the ones raising concerns. On mental health, as well as the additional funding, as Jim Hume said, we need to see parity of treatment between mental and physical health. On A&E waiting times, the government must face the fact that it is not meeting its targets and is going in the wrong direction. And on the crisis in GP recruitment, ministers have been warned about the looming problem for years. 99% of GPs who had heard about the government's plans say they are insufficient. The Royal College have put forward a blueprint. SNP ministers need to take their head out of the sand and respond positively. Finally, Presiding Officer, let me turn to the education, apparently the flagship for this programme. I don't at all question the sincerity of the First Minister's desire to tackle inequality in education. I do have serious questions, though, about the way she's going about it. Like George Adam, Nicola Sturgeon claims she wants to, quote, close the attainment gap completely between children from poorer backgrounds and their more affluent counterparts. She's even asked to be judged on her actions to achieve this goal. So this is not just an ambition, but a firm, measurable and absolute goal. Yet how can this be achieved when her attainment fund ignores the needs of those in poverty living in all but half a dozen council areas or attending around 50 schools elsewhere? Unlike the pupil premium proposed by Liberal Democrats and delivered south of the border, this broad brush approach does not target the individuals who need it. So it will do nothing for thousands of individual children from poorer backgrounds across Scotland, and it means there is no prospect of the First Minister honouring her commitment. On standardised testing too, we have concerns. Liberal Democrats abolished 5-14 testing, teaching to the test and league tables. Nicola Sturgeon insists her plans won't take us back to the future. She's even persuaded the EIS to voice conditional support. But there's a reason the only people who have been calling for standardised testing were the Tories. They have been consistent on this issue and they are delighted. And that at least should give Ms Sturgeon pause for thought. Meanwhile, the Higher Education Bill betrays the SNP's control freakery. We know that the best performing universities globally are those free to exercise responsible autonomy, but the SNP can't resist. Even their rhetoric about wanting to meddle is damaging to the reputation of our world-class universities. Deputy Presiding Officer, the role of this Parliament, MSPs in all parties, including the SNP, is to hold government to account on what it does, not just on what it says it's doing or has done. That is what we on these benches will continue to do. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Anna McGoldie. 8 minutes, please, Ms. Goldie. Deputy Presiding Officer, this lengthy debate commencing yesterday has encompassed many words, opinions and views. Now, having become something of a fixture here, I've witnessed various programmes for government, so some of this programme was predictable and worthy, to be fair, if not necessarily innovatory nor radical. The First Minister, in a workmanlike speech, laid out her vision for Scotland and announced 8 new bills. And few will take issue with measures to address domestic abuse, the conduct of lobbyists to regulate burial and cremation law or set Scottish Parliament election dates. However, the Budget Bill, the Bankruptcy Consolidation Bill and the Private Tenancies Bill will all require to be judged on content, not title, before any meaningful comment can be made. And as for the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill, unless it separates the Scottish Office of Budget Responsibility from any connection with or tie to government, it will not be worth the paper it is written on. Well, I'm characteristically generous to the Cabinet Secretary for finance.
Mr. Swinney, if you wish to make interventions, please do not do so from a sedentary position.
Well, I'll give Mr. Swinney the opportunity to make one standing position.
I'm just asking, interested to invite Ms. Goldie to set out to Parliament what constructive contribution she's made to the consultation exercise on the contents of the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill.
I leave that to my colleagues who know something about it, and I'm sure the consultation... I'm sure the consultation will be much enhanced by that approach. I have to say, Deputy Presiding Officer, that what was notable about the First Minister's speech was not the lengthy list of proposals, intentions, aspirations and the 8 bills, but it was a glaring absence of any analysis and review of our own party's 8 years in government, and many members have commented on this. Now, had she had such courage, this might have led her to exciting and innovatory changes to policy consequent upon such analysis and review, but we waited in vain. There was one exception. An exception, Deputy Presiding Officer, which proves the need for and relevance of determined and competent opposition in this Parliament. The First Minister will reintroduce tests in literacy and numeracy for primary school children. Now, I know, had it not been for the fearless, relentless and enduring criticism by my colleague Liz Smith of Scottish Government policy, not even that concession would have been made. So that is welcome, but it is overdue. But let me assist the First Minister with addressing her omission, and let me offer my own review and analysis. Police Scotland is not working satisfactorily, so the First Minister will hold a review of governance. Well, I don't think anyone will disagree with that assessment. When her government decided to create a single police force, my party was clear about and warned repeatedly that you could not vest the control of law enforcement of a country in very few hands without transparent, visible safeguards to protect the public interest. Our entreaties fell on deaf ears, and Labour, unable to offer any coherent analysis of the proposals, fell in with the SNP and supported a single police force proximate to government with the public interest protected by a quangle. It was always going to end in tears, which is why my party refused to support the measure. Now, from the outset, it was clear that the structure was unstable, and civil servants should have been instructed to work out an alternative so that yesterday, not a review, but meaningful proposals could have been announced in order that an incoming chief constable has clarity about the police force and the incoming head of the SPA, if it's to continue, also knows what is required. Because this continuing vacuum is damaging and destabilising, and it was avoidable. Now, on the NHS, the First Minister has various ideas, not least some interesting rhetoric about getting to grips with local health care, treating people locally, thereby keeping them out of hospital. Well, it may have slipped off our radar screen, but not only are we struggling to recruit GPs to existing practices, but there is evidence that new entrants to the medical profession are not choosing general practice as their future. We have known over the last 8 years that our population is proportionately ageing faster than the rest of the UK. Our GPs are already seeing that with intensifying demand for services to that cohort of patients. And believe me, Presiding Officer, I'm taking a keen personal interest in all of this. Yet not only has the Scottish Government no strategy for dealing with this, the Scottish Government is now proclaiming a new approach to increase the workload of GPs, many themselves ageing with no clear idea of where their successors are to come from or who is to deal with these new responsibilities. And this is after 8 years of the SNP
being responsible for the health service. And I looked again at the programme for government section on health, and what I have are aspirations to increase numbers of medical students. I have aspirations to increase the output from medical schools, and not one whit of information about how you do that or how you start the process, what it will cost, or what the end point of delivery is to be. So there is a total absence of forensic analysis, a Scottish Government complacency to a challenge which was becoming apparent years ago, and a deafening silence and a strategy to respond to that challenge. But there was another area of eerie silence. The Scottish Parliament will acquire significant new powers with the passing of the Scotland Bill, and this Parliament will be the third most powerful sub-legislator in the world. We will be raising income tax, we will be responsible for significant welfare payments, we'll be having to look at how we cut our coat according to the cloth. So where did this all feature in the First Minister's vision? I heard a lot about expenditure, capital expenditure, infrastructure projects, revenue expenditure and a real living wage, money for a housing fund, and implicit in all of this, more money to be spent in welfare provision than currently. I heard a great deal about encouraging business, making Scotland the best place in the UK in which to do business. That is a fine aspiration, but as my colleague Murdo Fraser pointed out, what about a review of business rates? That's one of the taxes for which this government has responsibility, and that impacts significantly on high street retailers. And Murdo Fraser was also right to point out Scottish business wants to know what's coming down the line in terms of taxation. So what is the outline shape of the Scottish economy? How much more will be spent in welfare? Kevin Stewart criticised the reduction in working tax credits. I presume he supports people earning more than £60,000 being subsidised by the taxpayer. So, when a Scottish Government reinstates working tax credits, how much will that cost and where is the money coming from? Presiding Officer, this programme for government would have enjoyed much more credibility if there had been a candid review and assessment of 8 years in power, a robust and frank recognition that all has not gone and is not going well, and specific proposals spelled out to deal with these failings. Where there was no silence was the now ritual froth and fuming about the Westminster Government, whose transgression in the eyes of the SNP is to grow the Scottish economy, increase employment, reduce unemployment, cut taxes for over 2 million people in Scotland, and leave working people with more of their own money in their pockets at the end of the month. That the SNP should concentrate in criticising such major improvements for those of us who are in the working population is enough to say about their perversity in terms of their priorities. Deputy Presiding Officer, this Scottish Government is short of innovatory ideas for doing things differently and better. It has become hidebound within a constitutional debate to which it is still captive. It is still in the business of gripe, gurn and resentment. Well, Scotland needs better. Scotland wants to move ahead within the UK. Scotland is waiting for exciting new political thinking. That will not come from the SNP. It will come from the Scottish Conservatives.
Thanks very much. I now call on Ian Gray. 12 minutes, please, Mr Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've heard many pleas from the government speakers for opposition. Speakers, not to be too churlish about the programme for government or to be generous, as Mr Swinney was asking from his seat just a moment ago. So, always keen for pointers, I had a look back at how the First Minister used to respond to these debates when she led the SNP opposition here. I particularly liked the response which opened with the unforgettable, almost Churchillian phrase, "I do not know about broccoli curry, but the First Minister certainly likes his mince." So I will try to channel that degree of positivity and generosity as far as I'm able today. And indeed, the programme for government unveiled yesterday isn't all mince. It contains many measures which members from across the chamber on all sides have supported. For example, legislation to ensure that the baby ashes scandal can never happen again. The outlawing of revenge porn, which Christina McKelvey, I thought, eloquently described the importance of. A right to voice technology for those who need it. All good. The programme also contains some measures which command our support, as well as the government, if perhaps not that of the Tory benches. The abolition of fees for employment tribunals, extending the duty to publish gender gap information, the Fair Work Convention, and indeed opposition to the Tory government's trade union bill, which, as Kezia Dugdale made very clear, we will support too. All good. But, Presiding Officer, there are so many measures here which are really about correcting the mistakes of the government's last 8 years. An inquiry into Police Scotland, of course. But there is also the announcement on payments to kinship carers, so welcome, but so long in the making. First promised in 2007. To paraphrase Jackson Carlow from yesterday, there are governments in history who have won a world war, defeated global fascism, created the NHS, or negotiated our entry into Europe in less time than it has taken this government to meet that commitment to kinship care. Or the extension of EMAs. Very welcome, not just now, very welcome, announced in March, re-announced last week, re-announced yesterday, and for the most part restoring the cut to the EMA budget previously made. Yet we still have no action on bursaries for college students, which have to be bailed out year after year as they fall into crisis. And then there's rent controls, something this government have resolutely blocked for years. And now we have a timid, half-hearted admission that they were wrong. But how many Scots have suffered crippling rents in the meantime? And what two of the one-time priorities which failed to make the cut at all? I think Patrick Harvey was right to point out that climate change gets a page in the document, but it did not get a word in the statement. And Sarah Boyack, right to raise fuel poverty, due to be abolished by law next year, but that didn't make the programme at all. Now, say what you like about the First Minister's predecessor, but his programmes for government had a bold sweep on these issues. Who can forget the most ambitious climate change targets in the world? The Saudi Arabia of the seas. Of course, these things meant little because they had no idea how they were going to deliver on carbon targets, and they have failed, or on marine energy. But for wild hyperbole, they were top-notch. My favourite was Scotland, the first hydro nation on the face of the planet. So bold was this programme for government that none of us really knew what he was on about. As it turned out, neither did he. But my goodness, didn't it sound dramatic. In contrast to these days, yesterday's programme for government is a tired and worn-out programme for government. And I choose my words very carefully, yeah? Yeah, I've seen the polls today. I choose my words very carefully. I don't say that it is the programme of a tired and worn out government, because how could that be? We have a First Minister in an unassailable position, fresh from an astonishing victory in the general election. She commands an absolute majority in this chamber and in every committee of this parliament. She has behind her the most slavishly loyal collection of supine backbenchers since
order. Miss Graham.
First of all, I'm not supine, and secondly, the Justice Committee does not have an SNP majority. Thank you.
Ian Gray.
Well, I can only thank Christine Graham for that slavishly loyal intervention to help in the debate. In eight long years, a rebellious thought has never troubled once the craven collective consciousness of this bunch of parliamentary sheep. And now the First Minister is riding high in the polls, such that she tells us things she will do in 2017 and 2018, and 2020 untroubled by such trifles as elections which might intervene. As a First Minister, it would appear she is one who can do no wrong, and yet she leads a government which it seems can do so little right and nothing bold or imaginative. With one exception, if only.
Order! Order! Order!
If only we had the same slavish loyalty on these benches. That one, with one exception, the First Minister has failed to use that power with any kind of vision. That one exception is closing the attainment gap in our schools, and she has our support on that. Yet how big a priority is it really for her? Kezia Dugdale was right to invoke the Biden rule. Show me your budget and I will show you your values. Yesterday's statement committed £25 million per year to this educational priority, but it committed £125 million, rising to £250 million to abolishing air passenger duty. 10 times more public money to cut tax than to cut inequality. That speaks of a government which knows the price of an airline ticket but doesn't really understand the value of educational equality. And I heard George Adam argue that APD, if it were cut, the cut in APD, would grow airport traffic and help the economy. That may or may not be true, but on these benches, we believe that the greatest boost we can provide to the economy of this country is to unleash the potential of those young people at the wrong end of that educational attainment gap, and that should be our priority. What is more, the First Minister is in danger of letting this idea become simply a debate about testing. Look, we think she's doing the right thing, or trying to do the right thing, by correcting the current inefficient and inconsistent practice in diagnostic testing. But it is a year since she told us that she would do that, and the slow progress is fueling concerns that we are returning to the failed system of the past, and in some quarters, strengthening demands that we should return to the failed system of the past. The First Minister may think she's leading this, but she is in real danger of losing control of it. And in any case, unless and until we see more teachers, more classroom assistants, more literacy specialists working with families and parents as well as children, and until we see additional resource adequate to the task and see it targeted effectively, until we see new investment in teachers and their professionalism, then we will not close the gap, and testing will only describe our failure. We will support such investment, but we will do it critically when it does not appear and be delivered. But it is not just schools which need new vision. The First Minister could have taken the chance to shift the childcare debate into a whole new dimension, not just about free nursery hours, but about all-age, year-round, fully flexible provision, affordable for all, whatever their families' needs and their children's ages. It could be about quality of provision as well as quantity. The childcare sector wants that. They've described it in great detail in the Maclean Commission. In Scandinavia, they already have that. In Scotland, our families need it. And the First Minister could use her unassailable position to begin to move towards providing it here in Scotland. And the First Minister had nothing to say about the other great inequality which blights Scotland, the inequality of well-being and life expectancy. We have an NHS struggling to cope with 21st century needs. And she boasted of staff numbers on the very day we heard of record vacancies and recruitment crisis. Well, today we published wide-ranging proposals for the reform and reinvigoration of primary care and the GP system in order to begin to address some of that crisis. But where was the vision from the government for reform instead of the application of sticking plasters to a system.
You're in your last 30 seconds.
The truth is, presiding officer, this programme lacked vision. And where it has it, the resources and urgency have not followed it. It is a programme of fixing mistakes, covering up failures and patching up long ignored problems. Presiding officer, it is not that the iniquity of this programme for government offends. It is that its tiredness and timidity so comprehensively disappoints.
I now call on John Swinney to wind up the debate. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate on an annual basis will bring areas of agreement between political parties and areas of disagreement. And I want to start on the areas of agreement because I think a number of very thoughtful remarks have been made in the debate over the course of the last 2 days about some of the provisions that the Government has brought forward, which of course we will expect to be subjected to detailed parliamentary scrutiny, but which in principle command support across the parliamentary spectrum of opinion. Christina McKelvey has been rightly complimented by a number of members of Parliament about the way in which over the years she has pursued the issue of revenge porn, and I'm delighted that the Government is able to bring forward legislation to tackle that obscenity within our society. The legislation to strengthen the framework for dealing with domestic abuse has now got much greater priority in our society, and I think actually, to be fair to Police Scotland and the Chief Constable, Sir Stephen House, it has been a particular priority for which Sir Stephen House is worthy of great admiration in this country for the way in which he has made it absolutely clear that domestic abuse is intolerable in a modern Scotland. The measures that have been taken forward on the Baby Ashes legislation will similarly command comprehensive support in Parliament, and the measures that have been taken on kinship carers. And Parliament has warmly welcomed the announcement the First Minister made yesterday about the access to voice equipment to support those diagnosed with MND, so courageously advanced by Gordon Aikman, who deserves our commendation and our support for the way in which he has tenaciously taken forward this issue. So there will be, we welcome on the Government's benches, the support that comes from different shades of parliamentary opinion for some of the measures that we bring forward, and we look forward to the discussion and debate of those issues in the course of the remainder of this parliamentary term. There will, of course, be other issues which are not quite as unifying, and we've heard a good measure of that in the course of the debate over the last couple of days. And much of the opposition criticism of the Government has been focused on the record of the Government and the programme that we bring forward to take forward the agenda within Scotland. And I want to address a number of issues as I go through the summing up of this debate on the Government's behalf. First of all, on the economy, the Government has set out in the programme for Government the range of measures that we will take forward to advance the thinking we published earlier on this year in the economic strategy about encouraging a greater emphasis on innovation, on internationalisation of our business community, about the pursuit of inclusive growth and the necessity of investment in our economy. And we believe that those approaches are the right way to take forward the foundations that we have established in the Scottish economy. A Scottish economy which today has the highest employment rate of any country within the United Kingdom, where economic inactivity in Scotland is now the fourth lowest in the European Union, where we see Scotland having an increase in female employment and the female employment rate in Scotland now being the second highest in Europe. So if the opposition wish to scrutinise the Government's record on the economy, perhaps they should look at some of the achievements that the Government has delivered in strengthening the economic base of our country and creating opportunity for our people. Now, of course, there was criticism from the Labour Party about the stance that we have set out about air passenger duty. And it's hauntingly familiar to me of the approach the Labour Party has taken about the small business bonus scheme, which if you go round the country, you find countless businesses that are only in operation today because this government put in place the small business support at a time when individuals required it to continue to contribute to their local economy. And that investment has been crucial to stimulating town centre and business activity the length and breadth of this country. Now, if the Labour Party wants to look at the research studies that have been undertaken in relation to the impact of APD, they will find that a 50% reduction on the cost of APD as currently constituted would generate an additional 3,800 jobs within Scotland and a £200 million per annum gross value added to the Scottish economy. That is what, by taking these measures, we can improve and boost the economic performance of our country, create new employment for people, and give the opportunities that will allow people to have a greater stake in our society and our economy. And that is why the government takes decisions of those sort.
Now, give way to Mr. Finlay.
I wonder if Mr. Swinney will comment on how that impacts on climate change targets.
Climate change is one of the issues I'm going to come on to in the course of the speech that I make today. So Mr. Finlay can wait for me to get on to those remarks. So air passenger duty is a crucial measure in boosting the economic performance of our country and creating the economic opportunities that people want to see in Scotland. Now, the government's health record has been subjected to analysis by Parliament today. But of course, what we see is that the Scottish Government, the share of the Scottish budget taken up by health has increased from when we came to office from 37.4% to 41.2%. So this government has invested in the health service in a sustained and consistent fashion that the people of Scotland would expect of us to undertake that investment. I'll give way to Jackie Bailey.
Jackie Bailey. Cabinet Secretary for giving way. He will of course appreciate that as a proportion of the budget he is actually spending and his government is spending less than the Tories are in England.
That's not the case, I'm afraid, Ms. Bailey. And what the Scottish Government is doing is increasing the share of the budget that is allocated to the health service since we came to office. For the first time, a health budget higher than £12 billion invested in the health service in Scotland. And what that delivers for us, what that delivers is performance where, for example, 70% of outpatients were being waited less than 12 weeks when we came to office in 2007. That's now 89.7% are waiting less than 12 weeks as an outcome of the performance of the Scottish Government in managing the health service. Now, to look at education, there has been understandable focus on the attention on attainment that's been taken forward by the Scottish Government in the programme that we have set out. And that is, of course, to tackle some of the underlying challenges of the education service. But we should also look at the improving performance and the outcomes achieved as a consequence of our education service. In 2007, only 87% of school leavers were in positive destinations. By 2015, this had risen to a record high of 92.5% of school leavers in initial positive destinations of work, training or education. Since 2007, awards at higher level have risen by 35% and awards at advanced higher have risen by 42%, with this year seeing record higher and advanced higher passes. So I would encourage the opposition to reflect on the performance of the education system in Scotland, which is getting better, but this government is determined to put in place the focus that will ensure we improve the performance of the system and tackle the attainment gaps that have persisted within Scotland. And that is at the heart of the measures the government has taken forward. I'll give way to Liz
Smith.
Any comment upon the fact that there are 31% of schools that are not achieving good, very good or excellent when it comes to school inspection?
What that is a measure of is the assessment that is undertaken by an independent inspectorate. But what we are seeing in the outcome that I'm setting out here, what I'm setting out here is the performance that's achieved for individuals that is seeing better outcomes achieved for the young people of Scotland, and the opposition cannot ignore the fact that we are delivering better performance and better outcomes for the young people of Scotland. Of course, Ian I give way.
But this is part of the problem, because that's simply not true. The record higher passes this year is largely a result of there being more children in S5. The individual performances pass rates fell, and last year they fell as well. It's that misuse of numbers which leads to a lack of trust in government.
Well, if
Deputy First Minister...
Surely a key factor in the performance of young people in our system is whether they get into positive destinations, and we now see 92.5% of school leavers in initial positive destinations of work, training or education, which is something Parliament should be very proud of as a consequence of the work of our education system in Scotland. Now, we've talked extensively in the course of this debate about climate change, and I want to, as promised to Neil Findlay, I would address the issues around climate change. On the original proposition that was put forward, the Scottish Government would have had to have achieved a reduction in carbon emissions by 2013 of 31.7%, and we have in fact achieved 38.4%. So we have exceeded the original pattern of reduction in carbon that was anticipated when the legislation was passed. The difficulty for the government has been the changing and shifting sands of the analysis and the data that we have to depend upon. But we remain on track to reduce carbon emissions by 42%, just as the government is committed to and just as the government is determined to do. And the measures that are set out in the programme for government on energy efficiency, on fuel poverty, on the investments the government takes forward on sustainable transport are designed to support that objective.
I'll give Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Perhaps those shifting sands of analysis are one of the reasons why the environment is the one policy area where the SNP is not the most trusted party, according to today's opinion poll. Does the Deputy First Minister agree that in order for these commitments to be taken seriously by the public, the SNP is going to have to be clear before the next election whether it is on the side of Clough and Ineos and the others who want to add to the stocks of fossil fuels, or whether it is on the side of the communities being threatened by them?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, for a government that's got a moratorium in place on fracking, I'm not exactly sure what question Patrick Harvey needs to have answered as a consequence of his intervention.
Now,
one of the other issues that has been raised in the debate was about one of the major issues has been around policing, and the Justice Secretary will make a statement to Parliament tomorrow that will set out in further detail the announcements the First Minister made in the course of the debate yesterday. And there will be consultation about policing priorities and consultation around local engagement in the work of the police service within Scotland. But there was much talk about looking at comparative experiences about police services across the United Kingdom. And one of the things that I think we should be mindful of is that since 2007, there has been a 10% reduction in the number of police officers in the rest of the United Kingdom. And there are 1,000 more police officers in this country. That is the difference of approach. That is the difference of approach that has been taken by this government, where we've invested in policing in this country, and the UK government has reduced policing expenditure and reduced the number of police officers in the rest of the United Kingdom. So we should take from this. We should take from this. I'll certainly give.
Annabel Goldie.
The Cabinet Secretary. Is it not wrong, Cabinet Secretary, to conflate police numbers, which is he will know my party entirely approves of and supported, with the inherent structure of a single police force in Scotland? These are two quite separate issues.
Deputy First Minister.
They're not in the slightest, because we took decisions about creating a single police service so we could preserve police numbers, not cut them like the last government did in the United Kingdom. Now, Presiding Officer, in a sense, not at the moment. I've taken a number of interventions. Presiding Officer, one of the comments which I think has characterised this debate was the response of Annabel Goldie to my intervention in her speech. It was preceded, I would have to say, by some ungallant behaviour on my part in the chamber. But I asked, Annabel Goldie criticised the approach that we were taking on the Scottish Fiscal Commission bill. And when I asked her what contribution she had made to the consultation exercise, Ms Goldie replied, "I'll leave that to my colleagues who know something about it." I simply make the point that Ms Goldie made a criticism of our government and then accepted that she knew absolutely nothing about the subject whatsoever. That rather characterises some of the interventions in this debate today. It was slightly outclassed by Liam MacArthur's point, which was that, to warn the First Minister that because the Tories supported something, it should give us pause for thought. I bet you there's a lot of Mr MacArthur's Liberal Democrat MP colleagues who now wish they'd had pause for thought about believing the things the Tories told them back in 2011. And lastly, I've got some gentle advice for Ian Gray. Ian Gray used the words tired and worn out. I thought it was a personal reflection of his contribution to the debate. But he then went on. He then went on to describe the First Minister as unassailable. If the opposition wish to try to marshal an argument that they have an alternative to put forward, I would gently suggest to them that's not the most helpful language to prosecute their arguments. And more importantly, well, it is for us, First Minister, I accept that. But more importantly, they've got to come up with a credible alternative to the government's programme, and we didn't see any evidence of that in the course of this debate. This is a programme which is bold in its ambitions for the people of Scotland, and we're determined to pursue it.
That concludes debate on the Scottish Government's programme for government 2015-16. We now move to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 14115 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14115.
Moved.
No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 14115 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of 5 business motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions number 14047, 14049, to 14051 and 14098, setting out stage 1 timetables for various bills en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
I propose to ask a single question on motions number 14047, 14049 to 14051 and 14098. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put. Therefore, I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motions number 14047, 14049 to 14051 and 14098 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of 5 Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions number 14053 in the referral of an SSI, motion number 14112 on committee membership, motions number 14054 and 14113 on substitution on committees, and motion number 14114 on the establishment of a committee.
Moved en bloc.
Questions on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are 5 questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 14053 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the referral of an SSI be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14112 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on committee membership be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14054 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on substitution on committees be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14113 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on substitution on committees be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14114 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the establishment of a committee be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed to. That ends decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.